And after you left full-time auto mechanicking, where did you go to work after that?
In a manufacturer of compressors.
Okay, what was it?
Joint manufacturing company.
Okay. And
built centrifugal air compressors.
Okay. Do you believe you were exposed to asbestos while you worked for Joy?
Yes.
Now, what did Joy Manufacturing manufacture?
We built centrifugal air compressors from about 500 horsepower to, at that time, Joy, 6,000 horsepower, like big turbochargers, basically what they are.
Okay. Now, in terms of a compressor, were some of the equipment that attached to the compressor, were they made by other manufacturers and purchased by Joy?
Not at that time. Early Joy, everything was manufactured pretty much right there on the spot.
Okay. So do you believe that there, as you sit here today, that there was asbestos components in those valves?
The gasket material, yes.
Okay.
And shaft packing.
Okay. And in terms of removing the gasket, of the tools that you described, was there one more than the other that caused the most amount of dust?
I would say the grinder. The grinder was a nice tool, did a nice job, fast. You can get in the little holes, and that was our favorite.
And were you the kind of gentleman that carried a handkerchief in his pocket?
I always had to.
Okay, why is that?
Well, because you get all the dust out of your nose.
Okay, what would you see when you blew your nose?
Rust, black soot. I call it soot.
Did you remove old asbestos packing from the valves that came across your bench?
Yes.
Would you manufacture the gaskets in the same way you described before, using the ball peen hammer and the power grinder and the file?
Yes.
When you would blow your nose after making the gaskets, would you still see that gasket material in the handkerchief?
Yes.
Okay. Would you believe you breathed in asbestos dust when you were making the gaskets?
Yes.
Do you believe you were breathed in asbestos dust when you were scraping and grinding the ones off the flanges?
Of course, yes.
In terms of the flange gaskets, when you were using the scraper or the hammer, did that create dust?
Oh, of course.
Okay, yes. And while you were doing that, when you were working at Joy in the 1970s, do you believe you breathed that dust?
Yes.
Okay, and when you used the hand wire brush, do you believe that created dust?
Dust was always everywhere.
Okay. As you sit here today, do you believe you were exposed to asbestos while working on those valves out in the field during the 1970s?
Yes, because we were cleaning the gaskets and servicing the valves on site versus in the shop.
Now, in terms of asbestos exposure, what, if anything, do you associate, what type of asbestos product do you associate with pumps?
Gaskets.
Okay.
Shaft packing. There are two of the only things that really are in a pump body, the gasket for the header, or the volute, whatever you want to call it. So.
Okay. And did you do use the same tools for the gasket removal?
Yes.
Used the scraper.
Scraper. My hammer chisel.
Okay.
Usually the wire brush, because it was more convenient and faster. And like I said, these were behind the boiler.
Okay, so. When you say the wire brush, would that be the hand one?
The hand one or the electric. Okay. We like the electric one.
Okay. And did that create dust when you did it?
Yes.
And when you used the tools to make the flange gaskets, did that create dust?
Oh, yes.
Do you believe you breathed in that dust?
Yes.
Now, I think the last product that you told us about that you believe you were exposed to would be some sort of electrical equipment.
Electrical, yes.
And what type of electrical equipment Do you believe you were exposed to while you were working at the Joy plant in the 1970s?
I always thought it was plastic.
Okay.
But later on, I found Bakelite, and they're just small boxes, basically.
Okay.
And you might have anywhere from 15 to 20 control relays. They're basically they're the middle piece between the wall power and a switch.
Now, this plastic material, which you said you later learned was something called Bakelite, how was it that you believe you were exposed to asbestos from that?
So we opened the panels up. You'd have dust, a lot of dust inside. It was enclosed. It was sealed enclosed. Knew it now. And then all of that black stuff, the plastic, it's what I would consider Bakelite today.
The black stuff is what you believe contained asbestos here today?
Yeah.
As part of this OSHA training, did you learn anything about asbestos?
Yes, I've learned a lot about it.
Okay.
Since then, since the 70s, nobody ever knew. We never knew.
Okay. Before you took this OSHA class in Louisiana, had you been giving any warnings about the hazards of asbestos?
No, never did.
You ever see any sort of skull and crossbones on any of the asbestos products or any of the equipment that you described for us that had asbestos-containing components?
Objection.
Never did.
Never did. You ever see any warnings on any of the electrical products that you described for us that the inhalation of asbestos was potentially dangerous to your health?
No.
Okay. Did you ever see any warnings on any of the electrical products that you described that asbestos contained in their products could cause you to develop cancer? You ever see any warnings on any of the electrical products that you described that you should wear a mask or respirator?
No.
Had you seen a warning or instruction on any of the asbestos products that you've described today or the first day of testimony, asbestos was dangerous to your health, would you have followed the precautions on the product or the box?
It was not on a box, but yeah, I would have worn my PPE. Personal protection equipment?
Sure. If they told you to wear a mask, would you wear a mask?
Yes, I would have.
Now, what you used to do, the things you used to do to enjoy life, has that changed at all since you became ill?
Well, dramatically. Yeah, I can't do a lot of things, swim, because of the other bladder cancer thing. I wear a bag. So that's gone. But the motorcycling was probably one of my biggest things or that I enjoyed doing and used to ride every day, and I just can't do it anymore. I just don't have took quite a while to get the upper body strength back, and I still don't have that. And of course, you got to ride a motorcycle, you have to have your balance. Aspects a lot more than driving a car, and there's a lot of things I don't do anymore.